have you started the live stream from Insta?
We are live.
No, you are not using Clubhouse.
No, we are not using Clubhouse. Okay. I'm so glad to have you here, sir. This is the very first episode of Founders Live Day. And I don't think I could have met a person like you who was successfully have two unicorns in India. Only person who was able to.
Thank you for all the kind words, by the way, is mine.
Yeah, right. So, sir, we are very interested to understand how exactly you were able to get your initial education. And is there any instance in experience in your childhood which made you think this way and sort of mindset you developed in initial stages of your life?
Sure, absolutely. You know, I was born and raised in Chandigarh.
Yeah.
And so Chandigarh being one of the most modern, highest literacy, highest per capita income, I was very fortunate to have 3-4 good years in the, you know, from the time I took birth, next 4 years. But my father worked with Haryana government.
Okay.
And when I was 4 years old, he got transferred into a small village.
Okay.
And because I was very close, I was the youngest of the 4 siblings. And very close to my mom, so they did not leave me behind in Chandigarh. They took me to that small village. So next few years, I actually went to a primary education center run by government.
Okay.
With no toilet, with no paper. Sometimes half of the time teachers are not even school.
Okay. Gotcha.
And for me, that was my first remembrance of formal education. So that's how things started, and then later on, you know, I kept on. My father will get transferred every 3 years from one city to another, and that leads to the answer for your question. That because I went from one place to another, every time I had to establish myself, you know, what is going to be my school? Am I going to get along with the teachers? You know, am I going to get bullied? Will I have a friends? Where am I living? Like, how will I go to school? And I did not realize that by the time I did my undergraduate, I had already lived and recreated my life 6-7 times.
Yeah.
And if you look at entrepreneurship, it is nothing but a prototyping. Like, you believe in something, you start somewhere, and you keep on iterating until you get it right. Right. So I think my life lessons indeed. Prepare me for this.
You started to become adaptable because
that's
of these sessions. And we were curious because we are in college life, we have so many activities going around the campus. So we would be interested to know what kind of activities you were involved in, sports, it can be anything.
Sure, no, absolutely. So, you know, look, I actually played cricket and badminton for under 18 for the state of Haryana. So, in fact, my parents used to be very worried after I was like maybe from my, let's say, later part of my schooling and until my high school, I used to be only focusing on sports. And we will, you know, we that time I studied in Fatehabad, which is now a district in Haryana. And we will as a team, we'll go to different districts to play cricket and badminton. That also in a hindsight helped me to develop a lot of chemistry, sportsmanship, team spirit.
Discipline.
Right? Yeah, discipline, absolutely. So that is one part. Second is I remember during my first master's, which I did from Indore, I remember there was some college debate. I'm sure your Delhi has a lot of college festivals and all. So we had one such festival, and that was my first time doing something enterprising to earn money. So I went to the local hotel operators and told them that I will promote your hotel during our festival.
Okay.
But you give some sponsorship, something like, I know IIT, Delhi, and so many other institutions do all the time.
Yeah.
And so you know, but yeah, so I think, you know, like, you know, thing is, you don't wake up one day thinking that I am now entrepreneur. A lot of you don't realize that your education, your upbringing, your reference, different reference points, your friends, each activity you do, ultimately lead to what you end up doing.
It's your personality from scratch.
That's right.
Exactly. Sir, I want to know what made you to choose the decision to go in abroad and being your MBA. Were you very sure that you want to go into business or you want to have exposure in from the international, you know, education? So
that's a great question. You know, actually, you know, I must say that I always wanted to be an entrepreneur.
Mm.
But But you know, I grew up in India, in that India, where the kind of opportunities we have today did not exist. Right? When I was in my early 20s, that is when India actually liberalized the economy. Right? So I, you know, so in India, the opportunities were very little. I was working in my hometown, Chandigarh. Somehow I got exposed to working with some of the American companies. And I was very impressed. That time, it was not common to know American culture, working culture. I got very impressed. And I thought, you know, I think I want to be there. Right? And, you know, eventually, you know, I wanted to be entrepreneur. But, you know, there's no way as in my early 20s as to, you know, I could go to US and establish myself as an entrepreneur. So I chose, you know, I already had one master, and I chose that I'll do, you know, my MBA, which will allow me to have a very formal education in a country where I'm hoping to establish myself. So that's how, you know, I started, you know, started my kind of, you know, education abroad. And but, you know, but it took me so many more years before I could become an entrepreneur. But yes, that's how I started.
You was like 10 years in Wall Street, right? And you are an analyst there. So
yes,
we are a few students in my campus who are into trading, and we are, you know, interested to understand how you were able to gain your knowledge from Wall Street and the way people, you know, see this is Wall Street. So we want to know how things were in Wall Street and what was your experience there.
Sure. So, you know, after my MBA, I worked with Schwab.com, which is that time was largest online stock broking firm. And after that, I worked with Microsoft in the corporate headquarters in Redmond, Washington. And in fact, I was very fortunate to have an opportunity to work with Bill Gates.
Yeah.
Then, after two jobs, I joined Wall Street, right? And I loved that career because I was an analyst. So it required a lot of, you know, detailed research, a lot of number crunching, connecting dots, building mosaic theory, developing knowledge and expertise on industry. And I also feel very lucky to, you know, I did not cover, and no offense, but I did not cover banking stock or airlines or insurance company. I covered internet.
Okay.
I mean, imagine in the early 2000, I was covering companies like Google, Netflix, Amazon, Microsoft, right? So it was great. I mean, you know, I would analyze these companies. I would develop my expertise on the internet sector, which was less than 10-year-old, maybe you're 10 or 11-year-old by that time. It's not 27-year-old industry, right? And still long way to go. So yeah, so it helped me to, you know, really develop a lot of subject matter expertise.
Mm-hmm.
And by then I also realized that, you know, a lot of time as a student, we have desire to know everything.
Yeah.
But sometime I think it pays well to be inch wide and mile deep. You know, I would say inch wide was internet sector, mile deep was knowing everything about the internet sector. And, you know, and today, you know, I was able to found two companies, and I can't stop thanking my Wall Street experience, which made me very, more than ready, I would say, what I ended up doing in India, the two companies I founded.
Like, you started with MBA, you went to, you know, working with Bill Gates Corporation, then you shifted to Wall Street, which was more like a technical side of the company, right? So, do you ever felt like I should have been too tech early in my life, or I would say that, or would you say that this journey was in sense good enough for you to understand what things are there and what to learn from that?
Yeah, see, that's a great question. In a hindsight, everything is 2020. You absolutely, you guys are all studying in a country's premier institution and very mathematically inclined, so you can do a lot of regression analysis, right? So in a hindsight, you absolutely have an opportunity to say, I could have done this thing differently, etc.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I think, you know, I feel very fortunate in terms of how my kind of life evolved in US and how I came to India, and one thing led to another. Yes, I mean, you know, I must say, when I went to US for my higher studies, that time I had no idea that this new age economy, digital economy, will bring this level of deep social, economical, you know, impact.
Yeah.
Right. So from that perspective, yes, I do feel that I wish I was part of that, even, you know, from 1994.
Yeah. Got it. I read somewhere that you were doing an analysis in Wall Street and you got to know there's a huge potential in the Indian market. And that time you realized that either I have option to continue with my money right now or I can go in and become part of that gold rush. But of course, that was a really tough decision to make. So we want to know that what were your criteria? What were thinking at fundamental level which made you to choose this tough decision at that particular point?
You're absolutely right. I mean, I had worked very hard to build a Wall Street career. I was ranked among the top three best internet analysts covering internet sector based out of Silicon Valley. A life, which took a lot of investment to build, right? But in 2010, made my trip, went public, and got self-listed on NASDAQ. That time, e-commerce was 17-year-old industry, right? It's like 2010, internet came in 1994, 16, 17-year-old industry. I thought, you know, there must be something happening in India that you have now company coming out of India and getting itself listed on NASDAQ. So I decided to write a research report on India internet sector and on Make My Trip. I flew from San Francisco, met founder of Make My Trip and 6-7 other internet companies founder. Those were the number of total companies in the entire sector by then. And that time I realized that, you know, India is now getting ready for prime time for the new age economy. And why should I just stay in Silicon Valley writing research report when I have an opportunity to create an underlying asset? So when I had that thinking occur to me, after that, you know, although when you are quite educated, you have high opportunity cost,
yeah,
you sometimes can do over-analysis. And over-analysis can result into paralysis.
Yeah.
And that makes you frozen.
Yeah.
But I somehow got lucky. I reached to a stage where I was able to tell myself the regret of not doing Shop Cruise, which was my first business, would be bigger than anything I gave up.
Yeah, yeah.
So I gave up my $1 million job. I gave up my life in Silicon Valley. I gave up everything I built in USA for 15 years,
yes,
and came first time with a one-way ticket to India.
Yeah, they say regret is the biggest disappointment you can have in your life.
That's right. That's right.
Right. So when you came to India, so of course we all know that.
And you didn't come in.
Yeah, exactly. This is the reason.
Yeah.
I think this place is closer. Interesting technology.
Yeah.
So the time you returned to India, of course the way you was working in Wall Street was very different the way you interacting in the Indian market, the professional area. So how you was able to, of course we know that you were adaptable from your childhood, but how difficult it was for you to, you know, change the way you used to work in Wall Street and then you work in the big media?
Another great question. I think I must say it was very, very difficult. Because, you know, one is India versus US. Culture, value of work ethics, for how long white collar multinational style jobs existed in US versus in India.
Yeah.
Right? So it's very, very different. Then within US, you know, Wall Street operates in a very cutting edge manner.
Yeah.
Very, very fast paced, very tight way people come, people who are very, very ambitious, who want to make a lot of money, who want to make impact, and they have achieve good education, and they demand nothing but best from themselves and everyone around them. So with that kind of, and also I work with 3 Fortune 100 companies, not just yet another company in the US. So I think that absolutely created a lot of gap in terms of how India operates and how I was trained to operate. So it was a fair amount of adjustment, but I had my share of frustration at times. Sometimes I also felt like just giving it up.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, that training also helped me to in fact lift so many other people who were smart, who were really smart, but they did not have the exposure which I had before. So it all worked out. But yes, it's India, from that perspective, I must say, is a quite harsh country.
Yeah.
You know, you cannot have just a soft landing, and
yeah,
especially when it comes from outside.
Like yesterday, I was having a chat with a senior. They are also working in a startup. So they were saying, Shashank, in US, you have value adding CIEs. You know, interaction with the people. You just need to talk on the value. They do not know the navigation. In India, you will have to provide the value. Then you have to provide the discount. You have to provide the feeling of FOMO. You have another 2 to 3 years, then you actually convert a really positive B2B sale, right? So the time you started, you know, e-commerce, you started in e-commerce, how tough it was for you to aggregate and bring the people who are doing really great in the market and tell them, yo, I'm gonna be better than Flipkart, I'm gonna be any other marketplace,
etc. Yeah, see, I had a very hardcore Silicon Valley training.
Okay.
And in Silicon Valley, if you're a technology centric,
yeah,
then they say place more emphasis on a product,
okay,
rather than on marketing.
Yeah.
Right? So I created, with short clues, I created India's first ever marketplace. There was no ride sharing, there was no food tech, there was no agri tech. Like literally for any category, short clues was the first marketplace in India. So my most of my investment went into product. Right? And because it was a marketplace, we were able to give selection and kind of products which Flipkart and many other companies were unable to offer that time.
Mm-hmm.
All the e-commerce companies that time offered was mobile phone, electronics, computer, very standardized item, very easy to source. You need one seller and he can give you 50,000 laptops. But what about Punjabi Juti? What about our clothing? What about shoes?
Mm-hmm.
Right? What about t-shirt and home furnishing item?
Yeah.
Like, you know, you know. So my choice of business model and the disruption I brought to the marketplace actually helped me to have a bit of an unfair advantage versus other more deeply funded players.
Got it.
Because of the selection. Right? And then all that selection came at no cost to me because I created a technology platform and there are those selections sat on someone else's balance sheet.
Got it.
Right? So this is how I got a start. But to answer your question, yes, FOMO, discount mentality, all that does play a much bigger role in this country.
Mm-hmm.
So I must say, first 5 months, in spite of all these cool things I just spoke about the innovation, etc.,
yeah,
we got beaten down. Okay? I remember launching ShopClues on 21st November 2011. Next 4 months, we will have 10, 12, 15, 20 orders per day.
Okay.
And we were very frustrated that why the customer is not adopting.
Mm-hmm.
And then I had already spent 4 or 5 months as a newly returned NRI from USA. So I understand Indian consumers some of these aspects. So what we did is we started offering a deal which we call it jaw dropping deal, and we offered a deodorant for 9 rupees. Right?
Okay.
I also noticed that internet speed in India was not very high, so every Indian carried 1 or 2 pen drive in their handbag or in their pocket or in their laptop bag,
yeah,
which was not culturally, I never saw it in USA.
Yeah.
So I made, that time I think the highest storage was 16 GB.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So I made a 16 GB storage that time available for 99 rupees, which used to be around 900 rupees. Right? So what happened when I offered someone a 200 rupees discount coupon, right? They did not take it. But when I offered a 9 rupees deodorant, we sold 12,000 of those in 1 hour. And our website will crash.
Yeah.
We'll get 1 million traffic single day without spending single penny on Google or Facebook
marketing kind of
like, yeah. So literally we did create some of these FOMO driven heavy discount, but we were mathematically very careful,
mm-hmm,
that we want only certain deals which can get people attracted towards ShopClues.
Okay.
But eventually, what happened, if you bought a 9 rupee deodorant,
mm-hmm,
2 months later, you bought a 800 rupees shoes. 3 months later, you bought a 28,000 rupees laptop.
Okay.
And 1 year later, you bought maybe a 50,000 rupees TV.
Right.
And that's how the flywheel started working in our favor.
Right, got it. The time you said that this is going to be your USP, selling deodorant for 9 rupees, and after you saying that people were buying other things. So how you made the entire company shifting from, you know, selling the deodorant and promoting yourself as a marketing team, we can provide you any product service, and how people actually started to adopt all the product features.
No, so I think because to begin with, we were very sure that all these 9 rupee or 99 rupee, they are more of a sampling of ShopClues.
Okay.
But ShopClues, it was not meant to be only a deeply discounted platform.
Yeah.
Right. We were going to offer every possible product or every possible category which is legally allowed to be sold or available online in India. Right? So you know, we ultimately we sold for selection, low price, unstructured categories, and 30 like a smaller series, right? And these were just, you know, these were substitute of how we would acquire a customer by paying very expensive money to Google, Facebook, and TV channels. So our cost of acquisition, so you know, deodorant you can buy for 150 rupees, right? We sold it for 9 rupees, but that was costing us maybe 110. So you can do a math, 110 minus 9 and maybe 30 rupees for shipping. That was my cost of acquiring a new customer, whereas my competitors were spending 2000 rupees to acquire a customer. So for me, it was only a customer acquisition strategy, rather than that's all I did for living.
Got it. So a person coming from US, settling in India, trying to pull up a company which was very tough, and then become a unicorn. So how you felt at the day when, you know, as you turned unicorn, and how, you know, things around you changed after you, after that thing happened, and how you started to manage with the people around you? Because the time you become, you know, founder of a unicorn, people start to behave certain way, or you get more and more offers. So how you was able to channelize your things?
Yeah, no, see, for first of all, I really feel very, very fortunate that, you know, while in 2011, I was questioning that internet is 17-year-old industry.
Right.
But today, 10 years later, I feel that, wow, I started that early, right? If you see all the action in the new age economy in India has happened in the last 10 years. So I feel from that perspective, I think that makes me kind of veteran, right? And you know, when ShopCruise, my first company, became unicorn, I believe it was fourth or fifth unicorn for that time.
Okay.
Right? And fastest that time in Indian history to become unicorn. And one more thing, which nobody has been able to beat as a record even till date, is we had spent less than $100 million to become a unicorn. So we not only built a unicorn, we build it fastest and with the least amount of capital.
Yeah.
So this is something which I'm honestly very proud of.
Yeah.
And then, you know, look, for people, perception about me would have changed, but I'm the same guy.
Yeah.
I'm the same guy who went to US as a student, who went one job to another. I'm still a student of learning. I feel I'm a work in progress, but I feel very fortunate that, you know, I became part of new age economy in India fairly early on.
Got it. After ShopCruise, when you choose to become entrepreneur, automobile, well, there were already two companies, right? And I know that people around you were saying this is not the right market to enter, but still you did that thing that, yeah, I want to enter this market. So the time you chose to, you know, enter in e-commerce, you was clear. The time you chose to, you know, enter in automobile and starting from, you was clear. So we want to know what are your criteria.
That's
right. Where do you think that these are the main things on which I should champion on, and I go and take that plunge to starting a company?
That's right. So you are absolutely right. Optically,
yeah.
When I started Doom, optically there were multiple players.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, as per my count, there were 11 more players whom people compared with us, like Doom. Like these, you're right. But my take was that I was building the first ever e-commerce platform for automobile.
Yeah.
And none of those were e-commerce platform for automobile.
Okay.
Someone was classified.
Mm-hmm.
Someone was vertically focused automobile content provider.
Mm-hmm.
Someone was running a physical retail. Someone was just providing rich content, videos, rating reviews, and community. But I was going to create the e-commerce platform. And for me, the criteria number one was, is the ecosystem ready?
Yeah.
For me to have a e-commerce for automobile, right? India is a low trust market versus US, Japan, and Western Europe.
Yeah.
So when I started ShopCruise, people would not even buy 200 rupees Chetan Bhagat best selling book.
Yeah.
And now I'm thinking that one day they will buy a 5 lakh rupees car online.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So for me, the criteria number one is, where is the market? So everything, every company people thought is competing with me and it's a crowded space was actually not, that's not how I saw it. In fact, their presence made me more encouraged that there's a classified, there's a vertical content, there's a discovery platform, there's rating, review, and comedy. So all building, basic building blocks are there. Now I can create a e-commerce platform.
Right.
So that is one thing. Second is, you know, I learned a lot working with Microsoft, a few sound bites from Bill Gates, and then you know I was very fortunate to cover all these cool companies, internet companies from Google to Amazon to Facebook. So I had a lot of my set of learning, so which I applied not only in Shop Cruise but a lot in Room. And so one other criteria is, in my view, I will that would be in fact my advice to any budding entrepreneur also, that always look for a large addressable opportunity. So automobile is like in every country is like anywhere between 6-7% on a low side to 10-12% on a high side of the GDP.
Got it.
So I thought here is a very large opportunity, right? The basic ecosystem has already evolved to the level where I can think of coming up with the e-commerce model. And then I think I can disrupt this market through the use of technology and data science. So these were the, like literally these were the three criteria: market readiness, total addressable opportunity, and use of technology and data science. And that's how I started.
Right, so you do not directly jump into market, you take four steps back, you understand how exactly things are running. Is the market ready or not?
That's
right. And then you go to great. So let's say you are going to Droom and starting a marketplace, you have a website, right? And you have a exact USP in your company, which you can sell to the people. Right? Let's talk about the people in India. Normal dealers who are not very literate, they know simple business, right? Brand and recognition. At that time, what was your pitch? How you was able to, you know, convert these people to say to come to our marketplace, and how you will be getting value at the end of the time? Because at that time, these people are not that smart to understand
that's
what is a marketplace.
No, absolutely. See, for me, it was almost deja vu, because when I started Shop Cruise, people had only seen Flipkart ad on TV. They did not even know the word e-commerce that well. They had no idea what does marketplace means. And none of the small and medium businesses knew what does it take to sell online. Right? So that was for the entire India, for independent of any category. Now, at time of Droom, we are talking about automobile. And you very rightly characterized small and medium auto dealers.
Yeah.
Right? They don't have deep pockets. They barely know English. They don't have technology sophistication.
Yeah.
Right? But they do two, three things which you and I can never do. They can source an automobile cheaper and faster than you and I can do. They in no time can refurbish it and they can sell it.
Yeah.
Right? Our platform communicated to them that we are here to empower you rather than compete with you.
Okay.
Right? You don't need to know English. You don't need to know technology. You don't need to have deep pockets. You only do what you do for a living. And the rest we will do, and will help you to have a great reach out to millions of online shoppers, and on the way provide you reputation management, provide you standardized experience, provide you simple, easy to use tools. So long as you can read and write in basic English and can send and receive email, you can now sell your products online with Droom. So that's how we started, and you know, like we were able to actually create the largest dealer sign up for any company, independent of business model, with Droom.
Got it. Before you were to break the entire journey of Droom or Shopify for that matter, starting with development of the product, that is your basic website, and then going and getting the initial customers who can provide valuable feedback to you. So how you were able to get the quality people in initial stage of your life? How you focus that this is the time I should be developing product, this is the time I should be going to market, and this is the time I should be expanding my business to different audiences?
See now, after doing it two times, I can sound like a almost like a professor with a very scientific way how to do it. But honestly, it was hit and trial, right? I mean, sometime I think about the product idea and expanding it.
Yeah.
Sometime what kind of team do I need?
Mm-hmm.
Sometime will I develop the product in-house or will I hire a outside vendor? How much capital will I need? What stage should I stop investing my own life saving and take money from outside?
Okay.
What kind of office do I need? So, you know, like when you graduate from one class to another, you must clear 6-7 subjects with a minimum score. So same way, at any given point of time, I had all these different subjects. And sometime I will go into one subject deep, sometime to 6 subjects, but on a shallow level.
Yeah.
But I always knew that I must secure minimum passing marks to graduate to the next level.
Okay.
Right? So it was almost like a juggling multiple or kind of shuffling through multiple hacks, right? But I would say first making yourself ready,
mm-hmm.
that is it for me, and is it really why I want this is for me, and this why I want to do this.
Okay.
to sizing the market opportunity or getting some feel of how it is going to be, then thinking about, you know, your vision, developing a product, attracting a team, attracting a capital, and maybe having at least 3 months of visibility on a rough basis your execution plan. That's how I went literally for both of the companies I did.
At the start, you have a developmental product, funded as everything. Like they do the sales, they do the developmental product. So was you the person who was involved in the development of the product, or also it was more like you started getting people from the start itself? And how do you divide and channelize the energy? How do you focus on which vertical at what point of time?
So I'm a product person.
Okay.
I can visualize product, user experience, features, functionality. And while I did not have a formal training for that, I realized that God was very kind to me in terms of ability to solve a problem with the user technology.
Okay.
So, but I do not know the coding.
Acha. Okay.
Right. I do not know the coding. Very similar to Steve Jobs, he was a product person but did not know the coding.
Yeah.
So, but you know, I usually like playbooks. So, what kind of people I want to hire? I already had everything written down.
Okay.
What kind of investors I want to go after? How much money do I need? I had a presentation for that. What should be the product features? When will I develop them? I'm a little more proactive and hyper diet. So, I had a lot of these things ready, but for actual product development, I actually hired multiple teams, and my philosophy was that I need to start from somewhere rather than start at the best place, because I always believe in power of iteration. So I found one vendor. I said, buddy, why don't you start developing this, right? And then I started getting resume for the people we would hire. So we had parallelly, we had 2-3 outside vendors, we had 2-3 team members, and that's how it started.
So when you wasn't, you know, part of the India, you can have the great quality, you know, network in India so that you can fetch the quality talented people working in the tech. So how you were able to reach out to quality talents, and on the time you were able to get these people, because for a tech person, he is into coding or he has a really good understanding of the tech, how you were able to tell the person, see, this is you should be doing, and how you were able to understand the language of that particular person.
Yeah. See, so I did not know coding, but everything else you asked, I knew it very well. So in terms of program management, setting expectation, laying down the business requirement, getting a weekly, periodically, daily update,